There are a lot of at-home masks circulating the internet, from stitched masks to 3D printed face shields and respirators. For the last week, I've been stitching, printing, and learning about the space of personal protective equipment done at home, and I'm going to show you what I learned. Let's dive in. But first, a warning. Personal protective equipment and any material that is not certified by the FDA can be dangerous. And so if you're looking at this space, really consider this type of material a last resort. Even there, some of these devices can be dangerous if they're not certified. So please take care, please be safe. So that being said, let's dive into three areas that people can start making right now. The first is sewn masks. And sewn masks, there's a lot of designs that can be made with simple at-home equipment, fabric, and they can be cut to form and face. There's a number of different designs, but they're all fairly straightforward and can be made either by hand or with the aid of a sewing machine. All it requires is some fabric and a little bit of time. So I'm not endorsing any particular design, but they are all fairly straightforward. When you are stitching one of these masks, do take care to use the proper material. Some of the research I found suggests that cotton t-shirt is one of the best material for filtering out small particles and working with this type of design. Now, some of the designs that I've seen advocate for using a heat air filter, sometimes certified as a MERV filter, to filter out additional material. Again, I haven't been able to find any qualification that this is adequate for these types of masks. Again, these types of masks aren't going to be airtight seals to your face. They're going to provide protection against large droplets, medium to large size droplets, but they're not going to be airtight. So lots of hospitals and staff are using these on top of regulated N95 masks to provide an additional barrier of protection and allow their N95s to last longer. I'm also hearing that people are using these masks not just for the staff and not just for the doctors and nurses and physicians, but also for patients who would traditionally not be given a mask because of the shortage. These types of hand-sewn masks are easy to produce and they provide an additional barrier of protection for both patients and physicians. The second area I want to talk about is 3D printed PPE. And there's kind of two areas of 3D printing personal protective equipment that is worth talking about. The first I will call is ready for production use. And these can be things like face shields. There's other things that are ready to print, but they provide ready to use protection. They're very simple in their design. The second area I want to explore is R&D. And there's lots of examples of R&D. These are things that are being developed. They're not necessarily qualified and tested to be safe, so definitely use a lot of caution if you're exploring the R&D space. But there are designs that are being researched to see if they can form a tight seal to the face and provide adequate protection similar to an N95 style mask. So on the production side of things, face shields are the most simple and straightforward to produce. There's lots of designs of face shields available, and I'll link a few below. Face shields provide protection for the eyes, nose, and face from large droplets. It provides added protection for folks wearing an N95 mask to make sure their eyes and their face is safer. So a design like this really can consist of as few as two parts. One part is for the face shield, and this goes right over the face. And the second part is just a clear piece of acrylic that protects the face. Again, oh, let's try that again. So very simple design, two pieces. One piece goes over the face, and the other protects the face from large droplets and sprays. And again, you can wear your glasses, or you could wear a respirator, N95, and traditional cloth mask underneath this as well. So the reason I call these R&D is they require additional testing to make sure that they're safe. One of the simple tests is called a fit test, where this type of device is put on the face and you check that there's a pressure seal, both positive pressure and negative pressure, for keeping that device sealed to your face. But there's other tests for both filtration, exhalation, and inhalation that have to be done to make sure that these devices are really safe. The last thing you want to do is put a 3D printed part out into the world and have it either cause a false sense of security for that staff when it's actually not safe, or introduce either cleaning or sterilization issues. So all of those issues are being looked at, but there's a lot of really exciting R&D going into the space. And what's been really exciting over the last 2 weeks is so many amazing companies are rolling up their sleeves to offer their help, to offer their expertise in terms of filtration, in terms of fabric. I've seen companies like Gap, New Balance, and Bauer, just to name a few, really both rolling up their sleeves from an engineering perspective, but also putting their factories to work in terms of how their factories can switch from making sneakers to switch to making filters and masks. So just amazing to see the community really diving into research and development to see how we can solve this shortage together. So before I go further into masks and R&D, it's worth taking a small detour to really understand how small coronavirus is. We don't usually think in microns, so I thought I'd give you a visual. All right, so to understand how small the coronavirus, we have to do a little thought experiment. So imagine that one hair on my head was as wide as this entire road. And if you imagine my hair being just as wide as that entire road, about 50 microns, then the coronavirus is as small as this tiny little broccoli here. And that's incredibly small if you imagine that being a hair. But if you think about normal filters, a normal filter is only able to filter out something about the size of this garbage can, something almost 4.5 feet tall. So it's so incredibly important that filters are really tested and validated and can really filter out some of the smallest particles that you have. That's just to give you a sense of scale. This coronavirus is incredibly small, and so getting the validation and testing of these filters is incredibly important. So there's three major problems. One is getting a really tight seal to the face. The second is sourcing and getting that filter material and making sure that that filter material is really going to be protecting all the way down to those tiny sizes. And then making sure that that filter material itself is sealed adequately to the mask itself. So all three of those problems are really being tackled independently. And that's really what's causing the innovation challenge for a lot of the makers who are trying to put these together. In addition to respirator style masks, there are efforts to print parts for ventilators, overhead PARP style respirators, and more. Teams and individual makers are putting together incredible products and incredible prototypes. The R&D space is moving quickly, and I'm hopeful that one or more of these solutions can quickly and safely help the frontline workers. It's really exciting to watch innovation and especially R&D in real time. This stuff is changing literally every single day. And it's been inspiring to see these companies working together to really solve these problems in a challenging time. So if you have a sewing machine or a 3D printer, you can really get started in helping right away today by producing either sewn masks or face shields. If you don't have any of those, you can still do your part and help. Just stay home. Thanks so much for listening. I'm Greg Raiz. Till the next one, appreciate your time.